You've got to understand, if you go on the stage anywhere by the band, I take no responsibility. The band can destroy the camera, they can hurt you. I can't be responsible for that. Nine Inch Nails won't be responsible for that. So go up there at your own risk.
The way that we kind of fell into getting more violent and having a more intense show was very natural progression. It just kind of happened. And I think that's part of just being on the road that long, being around the same people, playing the same music. The whole fan idol worship thing, as we got more popular, on one way you could just sit back and say, this is great, I love this. And the other way, it could disgust you. And you can turn that into some sort of energy. I mean, for me, I like Pink Floyd, The Wall album at one point. Because when I was depressed or whatever, that was like a friend in some way I could relate to at that time. And tried to make that type of record.
I was faced with the fact of every fan in the world of mine is on my back about when's a new record coming out. Knowing that I can't put a record out because I can't record it because I don't have a record deal. And if I did one with our old label, it would have been ruined. I couldn't take that chance. I'd rather have Nine Inch Nails just die than come out with a lighter, smoothed over project. You know? So we did it under different band names and in obscure little places, that very depressing place, I might add, too. And just a heap of personal problems, everything at that time. It was just a way to get it out, and that's why that record sounds as mean as it does, I think. And I mean, I've had a lot of people say I miss elements of Pretty Hate Machine, and I realize it. I purposely took a lot out, mm-hmm. Unbroken. And I think I wrote good songs, but I tried to not make them as obvious. So there's no Head Like a Hole. There's hooks, but you can't. Sometimes you don't hear them the first time around, and you might have to work to listen. It requires a bit more work.
What I did was, after some experimenting and failing on a few different things, realized it wouldn't make the biggest impression, I thought, was to make a very honest thing. So the only thing I could speak about with any authority was my own personal experience, and tried to relate situations I'd been in, or feelings I'd thought, or dissatisfactions with relationships or religion or the government of the country I live in or whatever it is, and disguise that so it's not in a preaching way, because I have nothing to preach to anybody about, except this is how I feel. If you can relate to that, great. I don't consider us a political band on any level. It's not that. It was an honest thing. Now, the backlash of that is sometimes you have to deal with people knowing about you in a way that you don't really want everyone to know about.
I experimented with some real personal kind of journal entry type stuff. And although incredibly embarrassing to ever let anybody hear, I thought it was more powerful because it had an element of honesty to it. Anger got more into the part of it. A lot of my frustration about a lot of things became a bigger part of what was influencing me to write. And it became just a way to channel a lot of aggression and anger and sadness, I guess, out of my system. And I'm more inspired, I think, when I'm depressed than I am when I'm happy.
I become what I do. It's not an act. It was never conceived to be some persona that I, you know. It's not me. It is me. It's a different side of me.
So, joke of the decade. How does Trent Reznor's mother hang up his Christmas stocking? Answer, with a nine-inch nail.
I think some people can be very well-rounded and do many things at once and have a life and do it. I tend to, if I'm working on something, that's what I do. When I can't call friends back and I can't do anything, I just wake up, I do a record or I do a tour or whatever it is. When I started working on Downward Spiral, I kind of approached it as a big chunk of work rather than 10
songs that just happened to be written at the same time. I kind of came up with an overall concept that then split into several chunks into things I wanted to address, and then tried to write within those parameters just to see what would happen. And about a third of the way into it, I realized this is insane. I can't, you know, try to come up with a song, and then it has to fit in this kind of spot and the theme of this, and it should be this type of music, and I realized it was a bad idea. And then two-thirds of the way through it, I just abandoned that. And then two-thirds of the way through it, I looked and realized that I'd just done exactly what I'd set out to do without thinking about it now. And the songs all fit in the right spot somehow. I'm looking at, I mean, I got into music because that's what I like. You know, I feel fortunate that I don't have to clean toilets anymore and I can do this and I can sit in a room and make music, you know. And I think I probably bummed some people out that are hoping for, you know, Son of Head Like a Hole or, you know, my classic hits of yesteryear that don't seem to keep reappearing on the next album. But when I did those songs, that's how I felt in my head, and that's where I was, you know. When I did Downward Spiral, that's where I was for that. And I try not to be too concerned about two things. One, trying to please everybody what they're expecting from me. And secondly, trying to do something totally different just to be different, which isn't true either. You know, so subconsciously, things just start to come out. And they're from the same place in my head, but my head changes, so the sounds change. My monster really is my own head right now, and I'm just trying to come to terms with some things. And I think what I do best is express myself through music, but at the same time, it's constructive and it's also destructive at the same time, because it's a lot of reopening wounds, and somehow the elusive happiness or contentness seems always a couple blocks away. Listen to the words he'd say, but in his voice I heard decay. The plastic face forced to portray all the insides left cold and gray. Downward Spiral came out end of 94. And we spent 2 years promoting that record by touring. We toured and toured and toured, and the result of that was 2 long years on a tour bus where your world became a bit distorted. I found myself in a space that was a pretty bad place, actually, like emotionally and spiritually, where I was really just genuinely unhappy. And I've realized that as an artist, I have to draw upon a place where I have to examine myself and really try to understand why I feel the way I do about certain things, and have the courage to look into that mirror and see it. And now, in retrospect, I look back to that time and I realize the last thing I wanted to do was do that. The last person I wanted to spend time with was myself at that time. So I did anything I could to not do that. I took on projects like Lost Highway, like Natural Born Killers, anything that made me think I was busy, but I wasn't really addressing the situation. And it took me getting to a place of like being at the bottom and really having the courage to face myself and say, you know, you got everything you ever want in life, and you're miserable. And that made me feel worse, because I had no excuses. Like, I got everything I ever dreamed I'd ever get, because I never thought I'd get it. I got it. Well, at night, knowing that I've done what I think is very true to how I feel, and it's the most honest way I can express myself at the time. This record took 2 years to make, and it was 2 years of sleeping 4 hours a night and working 18-hour days every day to really mine what was in my subconscious and go with what I really felt was my best instinct of what was right and what mattered to me. And I base that on I'm a fan of music. I love music, and I was the guy that was buying vinyl, reading what was written on the inside, and smelling the way that, you know, the whole thing, that all mattered to me. So I've always tried to apply that to what I do. That was one of the last songs we finished for the record, and I think as the album developed, I was a bit more confident to explore some more vulnerable topics, and that was kind of a private thing I want to get said without getting too heavy. You know, I lost someone who was very close to me in my life, and I wouldn't felt the need to, that hit me right at the, probably the lowest point I'd been right before I started the record. And I didn't deal with it properly, and I felt the need through this whole process of kind of redemption to kind of find reason to the whole thing. So I felt the need to put that in there. And
you know, the last times I played, the last year of touring in 2000 was being sick every single day and lying to myself and living in this terrifying world of being physically addicted to something. If I didn't have a drink before I went on, I'd get sick, and it was just terrible. And that was soul-crushing year, facing, you know, just bad time. And I gotta admit, you know, the day of the first show, I woke up nervous, you know, and it wasn't like I want to go have a drink. It was just like, I hope I don't feel that way before I go on stage, you know. And I didn't, you know. I went on, and it was a great show. And the next day, I kind of thought about it, but not really. And then I didn't even think about it. It just became how I remember it being before that last year of touring. You know, it was something to look forward to. And it's fun playing live, and it's great to look out and know that I can't wait to play these songs for you, and I'm not dying on stage while I'm doing it, you know. Builder, officer, and far away is a place where I hide, where I stay. Tried to find, tried to ask, I needed to all alone by myself. Where were you? How could I ever think? It's funny how everything that's wrong with me changed. music's always been a way for me to try to feel better and get better. But I think the inspiration is coming from a less destructive place than it used to be. You know, my life really just kind of crashed and burned. I had to come to terms with being an addict, you know, which was something that I'd for a long time lied to myself about the status of, until it really was, I couldn't lie anymore because I was either going to die or I had to get better. And there wasn't any, I couldn't go forward. And so a few years ago, I did what I needed to do to get my life in order and took the time off because I didn't know if I wanted to do this anymore, because I'd wound up in a terrible, terrible place and I wasn't sure what got me there, and I wasn't sure if I could even still write or if I had anything to say. And it came out of it was incredibly therapeutic because I found that, well, I can write and now I can actually think again and I like myself again and I'm more enthused about working than I think I've ever been, and I feel like I'm not kind of anchored to this black cloud that's going to take me down, you know, that's going to descend on me. There is no you, there is only me. There is no you, there is only me. There is no fucking you, there is only me. There is no fucking you, there is only me. If you'd asked me that question, what state of mind produces my best work, 10 years ago, I would have said pain and despair and desperation and aggravation. And given the choice to punch a wall or write a song, I'd have to be in that mindset to get something out that mattered, or utter defeat. Or one of those things was the motivation to channel that energy into something that might be considered positive instead of self-destructive. And I think what I learned on this record was that I can create without relying on that thing. And I don't need to be in a place of wanting to kill myself to write a song. And in fact, not being in that place allows me to think a lot more clearly about things than I could if I have to be in that place to write, you know. And much like every other role that drugs or alcohol played in my life, I realized that that also was more hindering than it was freeing. And then that, a lot of that was a lie and a cheap way to get to some place that wasn't real anyway. You know, and I can function much better creatively as well as, you know, in life in general.
In a nutshell, basically, it was you know, me being American and me finding that, you know, certainly over the last several years, I felt a sense of kind of shame and anger and embarrassment at the way that our country's positioned itself in the world and its behavior and the current administration's policies, not only towards its own people, but globally. And I disagree with it, and I know a lot of pretty much everyone I know strongly disagrees with it. And I wanted to write about that in some way that wasn't immediately polarizing or off-putting. And after thinking about it, I thought, if I kind of set this in fiction and set it a few years down the road, maybe 15, wondered what life might be like if things kind of go the way they seem to be going, where freedom gets removed or something outrageous takes place and nobody does anything about it. And then the next thing happens and you're expecting them, someone's got to say something about this. And there's a little flurry of news about it, and then the next thing happens. And pretty soon, I mean, we already are in a place of madness that seems inexplainable. You know, I think if you would have sat down with the American public and said, in 2000, guess what things are going to be like in 2007? No one would believe we could be at the state we're at now, but this keeps happening. And it leads to a place where it feels like the world is about ready to self-destruct. And it's East versus West. the U.S. government has become very controlling and censoring toward its own people. All the news is propaganda, essentially. All arts are regulated and censored. And I thought, what might happen if right at the moment where the button's about to be pushed, something intervened? And that something might be God, and it might be something else. But that was the kind of backdrop for the setting of the record. And then for the record, I just wrote songs from the various perspectives of different people and factions that might exist in that world.
Last time I was here, I was doing a lot of complaining about the ridiculous prices of CDs down here. And that story got picked up and got carried all around the world, and now my record label all around the world hates me because I yelled at them and called them out for being greedy fucking assholes. I didn't get a chance to check. Has the price come down at all? I see a no, a no, a no, a no. Anybody, has anyone seen the price come down? Okay. Well, you know what that means. Steal it. Steal away. Steal and steal and steal some more and give it to all your friends and keep on stealing. Because one way or another, these motherfuckers will get it through their head that they're ripping people off, and that's not right. Probably didn't make any friends by saying that.
When I started on With Teeth, I was getting back into things and a bit timid, but then with Year Zero, Ghosts, and Slip, I kind of got into this, like, I think the times have changed. I think the way people consume music has changed. When I grew up, I would invest that $5 into a record, and then I'd listen to it. And if I didn't like it, I'd still listen to it, because that's something I bought, and I would drill it into my head. And I think now everybody's got iPods that have a lot of space on it. It's very easy to acquire a lot of music through whatever channel you get it from. And, I mean, I've got tons of records I haven't even listened to on my iPod today, you know? And it's often I'll listen to it or I'll forget I did because there's three other things that popped up. And I don't think people spend as much time listening to music as individual pieces of music as they used to. And that's made me look at it, like, why not just go in and do something? If the creative juices are flowing, which they were recently, not overthink it. Kind of go from the gut. And that in itself is scary, because the schedule we had with the Slip was so ridiculous that
3 weeks, right?
Yeah, there was no time to even kind of listen to what you did the day before, which was fun and exhilarating. I wouldn't do that again, you know? But it was a fun process, because it started as just a single, and then it was like, okay, I'm making an EP. The thing is, now that everything's under my control, touring isn't separate from records, and everything's in the same pot now. And we've just put out Ghosts in a variety of formats. We were asking you for some money for it. We were putting concert tickets on sale, and I didn't want to hit you. Here's another album, you know, I just feel like I'm trying to attack your pocketbook. So I figured I'd just take this, you know? Because also as an artist, it's nice to think that as many people as you can have heard your stuff. And that eliminates another excuse of not listening to it. It's free, try it out, you know, throw it out, give it to your friends, whatever. To be clear, I think that artists should be rewarded for their work. I do. But on the other hand, I can also understand why most people, and I'm speaking from my perspective here, I think most people, kids particularly, have grown up in a culture where they feel that it's okay to steal music, and it's their right to do that, and I can understand the factors, in my opinion, why that's come about, most of which lie on greedy record labels have made people mistrust them, and they have abused not only the artist, but the consumer. And I think if there was some magic way that, whether it could be a couple of dollars on your ISP bill every month, and you can download all the music you want, or something that, which will never happen, by the way. But if there's some way that as you, the consumer, can feel good about you're supporting the artist can divvy it up somehow. But the idea that people are going to go into a store and buy a piece of plastic to get a music that they're going to transfer over to here, when it's so easy to steal music now and exchange music, it's the business side of it has screwed things up.
about 5 years ago or so, really believed I was done with Nine Inch Nails playing live. It felt like something that had turned into a well-executed, aggressive rock band. And I've done it, and I've proven to myself I can do it, and I've proven to an audience I can do it, and I've done it, and I've done it some more, and I've done it a few more times. And I wanted to force my hand into trying something different. So I said, I'm done with Nine Inch Nails as a live entity. And again, because I was kind of tired of doing it, and it felt like I'd done this thing, and maybe that's all it can do, and I need to try something else. And then after trying a few other things, and having some good fortune in some of those things, and less than good fortune in others, you know, scored some films, started another band with my wife and some other people I respect. You know, it felt the desire to put myself back in the kind of center stage scenario crept up, and the idea of writing something that might be Nine Inch Nails came into my mind. And about a year and a half ago, I tried a couple things, and it was exciting, and that led to a full album, which led to someone saying, "Should you, you know, do you feel like touring?" Anyway, it's a long-winded way of saying the band I originally put together for this five-piece band. That we just played festivals around the world for about 6 weeks, was a solid, tight, aggressive rock band. But it didn't live up to the potential of what the album, the new album I put out, promised. And it wasn't quite as widescreen as I kind of, in my head, heard the music. So I reached out to Pino Palladino, who played on the album with me, to see if he had any interest in touring, and he did. And then I thought, well, nice to have some different singers on stage, and if I'm going to make this thing something else, let's just go for it. I hope my record sounds interesting, but maybe off-putting on the first listen. But I hope you listen to it a second time, because you're curious about it. And by the fifth time, I hope you go, I get it, I like it. And by the tenth time, I hope it's your favorite album. And on the 50th listen, a year from now, or 2 years from now, you're hearing things in between the grooves that I put in there that, on a different set of speakers, or in the headphones, or in the car, adds another dimension to it, and the layers of thought that can unravel. I mean, that's what I'm trying to do. I used to live in constant fear, and I was afraid of writing, and I was afraid of, I loved playing live, I loved executing, I loved that side of it, but that blank piece of paper was my worst fear. And I know now that staring at that piece of paper saying, I've got to write the best song in the world. How did I ever write that song? What was I thinking of? Am I ever going to be able to write something as good as that? Was that an accident, you know? Did I subconsciously steal that from someone and I don't realize it, you know, all those things. And I've kind of, over the years, realized I can put myself in places where it's more likely to occur, inspiration, that is. I can cut time out of my day to go for a walk, or I can ride in the car with a tape deck in my pocket, a little recorder. And if I'm thinking about something, capture it. Or if I'm in a place where I can lay in bed for an extra 20 minutes in the morning, which is when I get most of my ideas. And if I set that time aside, those ideas are out there. I just have to tune in to, I have to be in the right frame of mind.
Can you hear me? About 10 years ago or so, I locked myself away in a house in motion. And I said I was trying to write music, some of which wound up on the Fragile. But what I was really doing was trying to kill myself. And the whole time I was away by myself, I managed to write one song, which is this song. So when I play it, I feel pretty weird about it, because it takes me back to a pretty dark and awful time in my life. It's weird to think how different things are now. I'm still alive. I haven't died yet.
afraid to go back to that place because it feels kind of haunted to me, but I'm going to go back. And I'm going to get married there.